What up, what up, what up? We up in here. It's Wednesday. It's Beauty and the Beat Wednesday.
How you doing? I'm blessed. How y'all?
I'm wonderful. I'm glad I could finally get you in here. Discuss all the things that you have. That took a minute, huh?
Yeah.
I mean, it goes like that sometimes. We gotta, you gotta get ready for us.
It's gonna be all right.
It's gonna be all right. Hi, LaRon. This is my cousin right here. This is the engineer.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all know each other already?
I met him right here.
No
time. I got acquainted because you was late.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you know my girl TP over here?
Yep.
Hey. Okay. And usually Mr. K West is in the building. I don't know what it is.
Is he coming?
I don't know. It's a Wednesday, so we usually discuss like hot topics before we go straight into our interviews.
What's the hot topics?
You know what? You're going to have to go through the hot topics with me. Do you mind?
I don't mind.
You don't mind? So
no,
do you watch like current events, the news, TV, anything like that?
Not the news.
Not the news?
But I watch television a lot.
Actually. You watch television? Oh, okay. So you might have some insight. So one of the big headlines that happened yesterday morning was Charlie Sheen came out on NBC with Matt Lauer and announced that he is HIV positive.
Okay.
And that is a big deal. Magic Johnson even came out and said something about it, and he was like, you know, with the medicines and the advancements in technology and medicine today, that he could live a long, healthy life. But now
Charlie Sheen, though.
Who did I call him?
Didn't you say that?
Yeah, Charlie Sheen.
I was just making sure it was the right person.
Oh. I was like, it should be. Like, I thought I said something else. Charlie Sheen, you know Mr. Winner.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So he had all these, I don't know what his love slaves were called, but now they're all trying to sue because they said that, you know, they never used condoms and they, you know, basically he didn't practice safe sex. He was always bragging about, you know, the amounts of drugs that he used. And now an end result of probably his promiscuity has landed him HIV positive, and he's known since 2011. But he said he's been extorted by doctors and friends, families, people around him that happened to find out or whatever, that he just finally had to become public with it. So I think that's a big deal, and I think it's gonna bring the conversation up again. It's not that it ever went away, but that's a big deal.
Did he just start talking about it now?
It just happened yesterday. Ooh. I mean, well, he had it since 2011, but it was like, oh, he just came out and publicly. No one else knew. But I guess he felt like, look, I'm tired of paying this person $1 million. You know, he said he's been extorted for having people keep his secrets. He has like a 9 and an 11-year-old, a set of twins. He has probably kids that are grown. They're all, he has about 5 or 6 kids. They didn't know anything.
Well, I think he should have asked Magic for some.
Magic came out and was one of the.
For the potion.
You know what? He said that he's been going to doctors and that he's been cleaning out his blood cells and he actually doesn't have any of the HIV antibodies. I don't know how true that is.
Michael, I said Magic doesn't?
And what did I say?
No, I'm asking you.
I'm Magic Johnson, yes. You keep asking me questions, making me I'm like, what did I say? Magic Johnson, who has the Magic Johnson Foundation, who is a good friend of the show. Yes, he is. He's lived with HIV status for over what? I think he's 15, 18, 19 years strong. And he does do a lot of high expensive treatments that are, you know, internet, like Germany or whatever. He does like blood sweeps or whatever. It's medical terminology for that. But I think we should have an open discussion about medical needs and care, because we just had a psychotherapist, a marriage therapist in here. And she said a lot of things that they talk about in her office are men that don't identify with being gay, but are engaging in homosexual activity on a regular basis, or, you know, infidelities, because she deals with relationships. And she said it's so much the norm in her practice that she no longer, you know how you raise an eyebrow? Mm-hmm. It's like she doesn't, I know it's normal. I mean, we're 2015, almost 16. It's not that it doesn't happen. It's not like we don't acknowledge it. But I think that, I don't know. I think it just needs to be a really well thought out discussion. But that was really big news. Like, that was like the headline news. So you watch a lot of TV and you didn't see that on the news?
No, that's what was on the news. Remember, I said I didn't know watch the news that much.
Okay, you
see. But I did see like a picture of him, but I didn't really pay attention to it.
Pay attention, like, what is he talking about?
Yeah, he's like,
still
what's going on here?
He didn't lost the show or something? I got
but
you.
That's big, right? That's big.
That's big news.
You should ask Magic for the potion, because Magic still has the potion. Somewhere.
Magic reached out to him, so I'm sure he's going to reach out. He does, luckily, still have money.
Is Magic clear, ain't he? Or is he not?
I don't know what medically is, but he's definitely healthy. Definitely healthy and living. Whether he has it, I don't know if he's technically.
So is he back with the chicks?
I don't know about that. He's a married man with the kids.
Oh, yeah. So, he cool regardless.
Yeah, he's cool regardless.
Big Charlie, though.
Big Charlie, like, yeah, he just turned 50. You know what? Some other birthdays went on this week. Diddy turned 46 years old.
Diddy. Living.
Really? I didn't know that. I was like, wow, Diddy. Like, Diddy. Oh, and Peppa from Salt and Pepper, she turned 51. Wow. I know. Hip-hop
young
is
growing. Young ages, huh?
Yeah, young ages. Hip-hop is growing up.
Ooh. They've been here for a while, too.
They've been here for a while.
I actually saw Diddy at Playhouse past.
So I see you out at clubs a lot. Do you perform there? Are you just entaining yourself there? Do you help promote?
I don't do nothing. I don't do. I chill out.
You chill out in the scene?
Yeah. I mean, I don't promote at all.
You don't promote at all.
That's not my type of.
I got you.
I mean, I just got here, so.
I know. So I want to know, you're originally hailing from Cleveland.
Right.
But by way of coming to California, you stopped in Atlanta and Miami, living, what, both of those places, mm-hmm. or did you just visit?
I lived in my Atlanta and Houston.
Atlanta and Houston, I'm sorry.
And then I went to Miami, too, though.
Okay.
But Atlanta and Houston.
Right? Atlanta and Houston, you lived there. I got cousins in Houston. Mm-hmm. So what led the transition from leaving, say, Ohio?
I played basketball all my life in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. So I played basketball and I went to the University of Toledo and mm-hmm. played basketball there.
Mm-hmm.
In Cleveland, it wasn't really anything going on as far as like people supporting you. Like it's kind of like you have to leave to come back. I mean, son, don't get me wrong, like Machine Gun Kelly, it's a lot of people who do succeed.
I like Machine Gun Kelly.
I mean, not
I like
a lot
that
of people,
song he did with Waka Flocka. I think he's like a different kind of.
Who?
I like Machine Gun Kelly and I like that song he did with Waka Flocka.
Right.
Okay.
He like I said, it's. Wow, boy. So yes, it's one like you know.
It's not one like you don't feel as though say the home city supports the home artist and.
Because it's a lot of home artists. Like it's I know from Paper Punk, it's a lot of dope artists that you know that don't get the shine they deserve. You know what I'm saying? Until you leave and then come back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, I had opportunity to go to Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And where my family's at.
Okay.
So did you
grow up in Cleveland?
Yeah.
Okay, but then your family moved to Atlanta.
No, they was already in Atlanta, so I just went there.
Oh, okay.
And then I had family.
So who did you grow up with in Oklahoma?
In Atlanta, or Houston?
Okay.
I'm from Cleveland.
You from Cleveland, right. Ohio? So I keep saying Oklahoma.
Right.
So Cleveland.
Mm-hmm.
Your family doesn't live there, they live in Atlanta.
Right, my mother.
Okay, your mother. Yeah. Okay, cool.
So my mom is in Cleveland. Then mm-hmm. after I graduated high school,
mm-hmm.
I did the basketball thing, but it was more like a job to me. It wasn't like fun anymore.
Mm.
So
it's weird you said that. I'm not trying to get off the subject. But there was a really big deal about Snoop's son not completing his college career at UCLA or USC, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, whatever. And I remember being at the event that we went to for Matt Barnes and Snoop, and I was talking to Snoop just on the red carpet. I interviewed him, and another sportscaster said, so Snoop, you know, they asked him this really nice question. They asked him, what do you think about your son not playing football? And he's like, I'm not going to answer that question. He came straight to me. He was like, what's up? Like, blah, blah, blah. Like, he didn't want to acknowledge it, but I could tell that it was something that he was probably feeling really personal mm-hmm. about. But I saw this week that Cordell the one? He was like, you know, I really have been playing football for the last 12 years for my dad just to get his appreciation and love because I know he loves the sport so much. And I realized that what I wanted to do was entertainment. And so he did it. And once his father told him that he loved him, whether he played football or not, it created a whole nother bond between them. So he was happy that he stepped out on his own, like, creative faith and said, I want to do production. He wants to go into entertainment.
Right. So that's, like, kind of like the, you know, same exact thing. Except I played, my father, he was in jail. But he wasn't there, like, for my life. But he was there, like, and my mom and dad were never married or anything like that. So I was forced to play basketball a lot by myself and stuff like that. And
learn. Are you only child?
No.
Oh, okay.
So I was learning. I had to get good by myself, which I got pretty good, but it wasn't like, it was like a job. It wasn't like, it wasn't like, oh, I get to play. Mm-hmm. Like, no, I'm talking about in college. Like, because mm-hmm. I got to wake up at 5 a.m. to go to practice. Then I got to go to class. Then I got to go back to practice at 12.
Mm-hmm.
Then I got to finish class, go to lunch, and then I got to practice at 8. So it's like, dude, what can I, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, it's nothing for me to do but basketball. Which is cool because you get to travel and see all the different cities and mm-hmm. play in front of 20,000. But
so you enjoyed it as a sport. It mm-hmm. was a great hobby growing up. But as you came into your own music,
I began to do music, playing basketball, like playing around. We were on the planes mm-hmm. and stuff. We were, we would joke around and do music. And I was like, hold on, I might be kind of good.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how I got to Houston.
Mm-hmm.
I text my uncle,
mm-hmm.
and he's pretty, you know, paid in Houston. So I text him like, man, I want to do music.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, what you mean you in school?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, I want to do music. So he was like, okay. And he's really like, you know, one of these people who like, don't, who have to be right. He's mm-hmm. like one of them people. Like, mm-hmm. so he's like, okay, well, you send me a song. You make a song and send it to me, and if I like it, I'll give you a chance to come here. Now, mind you, I have never went to a studio before. I was still still in college,
mm-hmm.
so I never been to a studio. I never made no type of songs or wrote nothing down. So I was like, all right, cool. It was a challenge, so yeah. It was cool. So I found some dude in a dorm
mm-hmm.
who was a rapper. I mean, he was a rapper, but he had like a little setup, like, you know, his setup. So I was just like, man, let me make a song.
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. So right before practice, I made a song, sent it to my uncle. He's like, dude, you. Amazing. So he's like, all right.
What was your first song about?
My first song was about, actually, I was in the library.
Really?
Yeah, but I wasn't studying. I was in the library doing, I was in the library writing a song,
mm-hmm.
and a girl was watching me write the song.
And so you
were I said, I hope she don't think I'm studying. That's what my first song,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's what my, first song came from, and she thought, because I know she thought I was studying.
Okay.
Okay. So that's when my first song came, and I sent it to him.
Mm-hmm.
And he allowed me to come to Houston. And when I got to Houston, it's huge.
Music scene.
Yeah. So I began to get like a nice buzz there. So I used to perform a lot mm-hmm. at Warehouse Live and a lot of places. And I got in contact with Rap-A-Lot Records, and I got in contact with them. And a lot started happening. But I was like, hold on, man, this is not, it was cool, but I'm like, man, I want to go to LA. Something just was like, go to mm-hmm. LA, you know? It was just random, but, you know, I was just like, man, I'm going to go to, because no one ever thought I would be in LA.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even think about being in LA. But so I just told my uncle one day, like, you know, I'm going to leave. And this was like 8 months later, you know? So, I mean, I was doing good in Houston. Like, I was doing
Did you
good.
Meet producers? I mean, because it's like you kind of just said, I'm going to go for it. Your first song was good, so you knew that you had the drive was there, the passion was there.
I got there, I started working a lot. Like
with producers, yeah, you met a lot of people in the music industry. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. As far as my uncle, you know, he went here and there and talked to people. And
okay.
He really helped me as far
get
as that.
Get out there.
Yeah.
So but you didn't have any nerves about it?
Hmm.
Okay.
Well, my first performance was here.
Where?
It was in Universal Studios.
Oh, at that mic?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, the mic live.
Yeah. And then I did something else.
Stir?
That was, no, I never did that.
Oh, okay.
But it was at the mic. Uh-huh. That was my first ever performance.
Oh, okay. How was that for you?
As far as here is concerned. Oh, it was dope. It was dope.
Okay.
It was dope because
I saw a clip of it, but it was low. You made a YouTube thing. And then I went to IMDb. Well, we'll talk about that later. Mm-hmm. But yeah, but I saw something from it.
It was dope because I didn't know one knew me. That's what made it so dope to mm-hmm. me. So I was like, oh, man, I'm coming out here.
So you get
me.
To feel the energy.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to get into some of your music. You know what? I feel like I have this great interview going on with Mr. Dope Jones. And it's a lot of other stuff going on.
Y'all like, are silly.
Really, though.
It's all good.
Really, though. So what can we expect from your music? I'm going to let you introduce something because you sent this to us. But
mm-hmm.
what can we expect? I mean, you're kind of new in a sense as far as performing and getting yourself out. Are you putting together like a mixtape?
It's coming up. Yeah, it's called Seven Songs.
Seven songs, yeah. Okay. Is that your lucky number?
Yeah, it's my birthday.
Seven
July.
What? July?
July.
Okay, so you are Leo?
Cancer.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, try again, but it's cool. It's called Seven Songs, though, and it's coming out. It's coming out, huh?
So it's July 7th, right?
Yep. My birthday is July 5th, but that's the 7th month of the year, so.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so.
What you do, cousin? Do your research? LaRon is a rapper, too. He's really? Called The Executioner.
That's your... Man, I, we got it.
Yeah, you
I mean,
got,
if you like
sometimes
the name.
Sometimes I try to get him to little spit a little something, but you know, his nerves get bad.
So yo, check this out. I'm not only just rap, I do everything as well. I produce, I mix and master, I come from a family background, and...
He just graduated from LA Film School.
True. And also, I got my own radio show here, so...
Called The Only
Hip Hop Show.
So you're gonna have to come up with me. All right. So we got this talent. All this talent.
Of course. This might be the best interview, too, by the way. I'm stamping it, I think.
Yo, we got Sphynix girls in the house. You guys
else?
Need to...
You next? Oh, yeah, so we got a battle for the interviews.
Oh, you got a battle for the interviews?
No, I'm just joking. She seems amazing.
Yes. Well, you know, I added a little extra time to our little set today.
No, I'm just playing around.
Mm-hmm. How are you doing? Awesome. I like that
vibe. That's fantastic.
I'm trying to go shorter, but then every time I think about it, now it's one.
I know. I was just thinking of changing normally. It's a girl thing.
It's a girl thing. We have to. I don't even know if I'm having a good hair day. I didn't get to look in the mirror or nothing. Okay, so. Thank you.
Yeah, like.
So, Dope Jones. I love the name. I know your real name, but I'll keep it personal to myself because we might not want everyone to know. But I know that there's been a name change since you started to now.
Mm-hmm.
What was Epic is like Epic.
Yeah.
So what made you change it from Epic to Dope Jones?
The Epic, man, it was spelled EPHIC,
right.
Which means just each performance have it crazy.
Oh, okay.
That's all that meant. But Dope Jones is doper. That's
okay.
All.
It's just, I got you.
And that's my last name, Jones.
Okay.
So I'm like, why not keep some type of, you know, traditional
uniformity.
Name in it?
All right. So. Well, we got Dope Jones coming up. What introduce this song for us?
I don't know what song it is.
You don't know what song it is? See how he is? It's called Dopeness.
No, it ain't.
Is it?
It is. I don't know. Well, you the one that did it. It's your song.
I said a couple.
You did?
See? Oh, man, it's up to y'all. We can play, I got... A lot of songs, y'all. If you wanna.
Hey, now you gotta like, you know, I got somebody else.
No, not
you know,
to take
we
anything
all, you know, sit around. I don't wanna interview, you know, but I wanna
she
include
is silly.
You. What? What I do?
You got a speaker bust in Hollywood.
You can play Hollywood.
Hollywood from Hollywood.
Since we close to Hollywood. Ain't
since we close to Hollywood. Oh, I can't see myself.
Oh, right there. I ain't even see that though.
You on TV?
Would that be wild though?
You are on TV.
No, I'm talking about like on a real live. You know how
it's, we're real it's live. It's streaming. It's 16.
No, I'm not talking about this. Never mind. We gotta talk about that later.
Anyone
want to
talk about
it
like a show or something?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
You know what
I
mean?
Network
television. Yeah, like that. And you just like, hold on, like that. I said I let the people doing nothing but their motherfucking self.
Motherfucking self.
So how you gonna help me?
Help me.
You need to help your motherfucking
you
self.
Help your motherfucking self.
And I ain't Hollywood, nigga. I'm just doing good.
Doing good.
I'm just doing good.
I'm just doing good.
I ain't Hollywood, nigga. I'm just doing good. Hey. Yeah. Hollywood. Boy, I'm telling you, I'm done with you niggas. And these make believe dreams that you niggas be having. All this shit is fucking matters if you ask me.
Hey.
And all these new ass trends that you niggas be following.
Following.
I don't think you niggas lead this if you ask me.
Ask me.
Yeah. I can lead a fucking army through a war.
War.
I can lead a fucking team to a championship.
A championship.
My life is a movement, this ain't nothing made up,
made up.
It's on paper written down.
Read down.
Just reading the script,
just reading the script,
yeah.
Now what you gonna do when it's your turn to shine? But you unaware, being unprepared. Boy, this real life shit got niggas like you stay shitting in their underwear. I can see it, nigga, I can see it. You niggas ain't ready. I can see it, nigga, I can see it. And I ain't Hollywood, nigga, I'm just doing good. Doing good. Yeah. I'm just doing good. I'm just doing good. And I ain't Hollywood, nigga, I'm just doing good. Yeah, yeah. I'm just doing good. I'm just doing good. And I ain't Hollywood, nigga, I'm just doing good. Hey, hey. Now what you gonna do? Do when niggas say you can't do it. Can't do it. Is you ready for it?
Ready for it.
I've been ready for it, nigga.
Ready for it,
nigga. I've been hating mostly all my fucking life. It ain't nothing just to ignore, nigga.
Ignore, nigga.
Let me tell you, nigga, something about me.
Something about me.
Yeah. I don't give a fuck what a nigga got to say about me.
Say about me.
Oh, oh. Nowadays a nigga gotta have at least a couple million just to stay by me.
Stay by me.
I'm going for the title, man. I feel like the champ, man. I feel I can take Ali.
Take Ali.
Yeah. But I ain't Hollywood, nigga. I'm just doing good.
Doing good.
Hey. Hey.
I'm just doing good.
And I ain't Hollywood, nigga, I'm just doing good.
Doing good.
Well, alright.
Alright.
Hey, hey, hey. I'm just doing good.
I'm just doing good.
And I ain't Hollywood, nigga, I'm just doing good.
Doing good.
Yeah.
3, 2, 1, and we're back live on air, and it's Hollywood. I'm not Hollywood. I'm just doing it. Oh, so now you got the whispers, too.
No, I was talking to her.
That means you got the whispers, too.
All right.
TP, you so distracted with all that beautifulness going on.
Oh, Lord.
She's silly.
So we're going to get into Miss Sphynix. Is this Sphynix or Sphynx?
Sphynix, yeah.
It's Sphynix. I just wanted to get that because she's an artist as well.
Mm-hmm.
But she's a writer, a producer, and an actress. I mean, we're so multi-talented nowadays. So Keon, Mr. K. West is in the building.
West.
He usually goes over hot topics, but somebody else filled in for you too.
I saw it.
There's other hot topics, though. Come on. We didn't talk about that. They talked about the HIV and that's it.
Bruh.
Oh, that was not it. Don't downplay what we talked. We talked about plenty other things.
I'm assuming y'all talked about Paris.
No.
Oh, well, no. And that's what I was going to. I mean, like the burning in Paris, Nigeria, Egypt. Russia is giving a $50 million reward on anyone they could bring up, find out who did that plane. Because ISIS is not taking credit for it, nor are they taking credit for the bombings in France.
Well, prayers all to all around the world, because
Nigeria just has over 40 people died.
I mean, Nigeria to
Syria
to, of course, what happened in Paris, to Compton, to Watts. I'm always bringing back home to D.C., to Chicago, all over. I mean, the world needs prayer, big time. And I just ask for all the prayer warriors to be out there and, you know, hug your children tight and pray over them. And, man, it's craziness in the world. I mean, talk about, you know, what's going on in the world, then turn around and see Charlie Sheen,
right,
who knew about his 4-year illness,
and now that's why he's
4 years. 4 years. How you gonna know about that for 4 years and, you know, keep, I would say, you know,
that's probably why he had so much animosity and anger. Sometimes it's always an underlying issue when you project negativity a lot, and I think that's probably why he, you know, became so enthralled with drugs and sex and so many other things that we consider vices.
I mean,
we've touched on that already, and
good.
Because you're late, we're going to move it right
actually
along.
Actually, because he's not winning.
He's not winning.
Charlie Sheen, you're not winning, bro.
You know who's new to L.A.?
Dope is dope.
But LeBron James just purchased a home in...
Yeah!
I don't know what that means.
You don't know what that means? K-West does. Would you like for me to tell you?
Don't be speculating. Like, what's our host on ES? What's our guy?
Stephen A.
Stephen, you go Stephen Smith.
No, I won't go there. If I had my own speculations.
Go ahead.
Knowing that this is the last year of his contract with Cleveland, and knowing that this big contract deal.
So him and Durant year, is coming to the Lakers.
I'm not saying it. Mm. And as a Laker fan,
you would have the Lakers.
I'm gonna say that. I won't say nothing else.
I won't either.
I have something
know.
I have to say because I love when I give advice and people follow through. Mm-hmm. I told TP that we're all black.
Why?
I just said we're all black. Let me see how you looking all black.
Don't be telling her what to do. I might have wanted to be in.
I do. Because I walked in and said, wait, who's that?
Do you know Miss Sphynix Roze?
We met.
Okay. I forgot your name. Her photographer, videographer's in the house.
Yes.
Moving right along to what?
No, I said please, go ahead.
Please go ahead. Yes. Okay.
Your hair looking fabulous. You looking fabulous. Damn, yeah. Like I said, it's always good to be in here with y'all. Y'all be looking good, boy.
So, Nicki Minaj and Meek Mill they were seen at the VH1 Super Big Awards that just happened last week.
Right.
I missed it, so I can't give you any highlights. I'm sorry. But they were seen there, and they're also purchasing a home in Los Angeles as well.
Why anybody want to move to the West?
I mean, why wouldn't you? The good weather, the people.
Today's been hot, kind of, sort of.
Today felt wonderful. I didn't even bring a jacket inside, so we're good.
One other hot topic, did you hear about the guy that gave back the Woman of the Year, his deceased wife's Woman of the Year award because of them giving one to Jenna?
Say what now?
The wife, the husband of one of a deceased, his wife is in the military and she got a Woman of the Year award. And so being that Caitlin got one, he gave it back. He's in the military and he's like a commander. He gave it back because he said how are you going to give it to people that, you know, fight and do all that, and that's not even on the same level. So.
It's not. I think it needs to be a set of standards. It doesn't need to just always change. And that's it, and that's all. I mean, I don't know. I don't have anything negative to say about Caitlyn Jenner. I think he's following whatever path. I think TV has pushed so much to the surface with him. And you do so much for the cameras when you've been on a reality show for, 11 years? Mm-hmm. That their life is so public that they don't even look at things that we would take into consideration and not even think about doing public. It's like their day-to-day. They want, like, if the camera's not there, they probably wouldn't even do it. So it's become a normality that we can't always agree with it, but that's Cosmopolitan or whomever's issuing it. The ESPYs issued the Courage. You know, all of those things are being awarded. Yes.
I thought about this. Have you noticed that any person who has dated the Kardashian and core, life has changed? Lamar... Mm-hmm. Your boy with the beard, James Harden.
I heard they're back together. Just a quick update on Lamar. They say he's getting better. He had a kidney situation, I guess, previously that he's come out of. But now the special prosecutor in whatever little bitty hick town that was in Nevada is trying to file felony charges against him for having cocaine in his system.
That part.
They said it's never been done.
That part.
And I'm like, so why now? But I understand that there might be a criminal aspect of it, but I mean, how do you know it wasn't induced and given to him at that ranch?
That's what I'm saying.
I don't know what happens in the bunny ranch, and neither do they.
But I know this. Anyone who has dealt with the Kardashians, and I ain't got nothing but love and respect for them. They handle their business. They make their money. I just know that anyone who deals with the Kardashians, from the Jenner, who is now Caitlyn, to...
Kris Jenner, happy birthday. She just turned 60 years old and had a $2 million birthday party last week.
What?
Killer. That's dope.
Mm-hmm. What?
$2 million.
$2 million? What would you do if I threw you $1 million birthday party?
Have a fucking ball.
Open bar? Forget open bar.
We'd be at a destination for sure.
Oh, without a doubt.
Butlers.
You know,
special treats.
We'll bring dope along.
That's killer.
Dope performances, food.
Dope gonna do some dope performances. Make that happen.
I love to eat.
Yeah. Where does it go?
I was at Tyree's party and his party was dope.
He has really nice parties. Where at his house?
Yeah.
When was that, after the Grammys?
I went to the one after the
BET. With Robbie Reed?
I went to the one after the BET Awards. Oh, yeah. And I went to the one after Halloween.
Okay, well, go ahead.
But it was cold, though.
Dope doesn't like to talk about all these people he knows.
Right.
And we're not name droppers. We're not big name droppers either, but we're very, known amongst this community.
I didn't say nothing.
I know you didn't. I like the humbleness in you. But, yeah, but, I mean, I think that's how you get around a network or whatever. Shout out to Tyrese, who's going the independent route, and still he's over, what, 200,000? He's making really good sales with the Black Rose album.
I do have something to talk about.
Yes.
You find this intriguing.
Mm-hmm, but we're going to keep it going
because I had a chance to go to a 3-hour meeting about the show Empire.
Mm.
And basically watched the next 2 episodes, one of them's being showed tonight, one next week.
Mm-hmm.
And basically they wanted to know, why have the ratings dropped?
Okay.
I think we've already talked about that, but we all know why, if we want to talk about the elephant in the room. The Trump.
That's what you think.
Huh?
That's what you think.
I mean, why you think? I mean,
I know personally my schedule does not really allow for me to just go and sit down at 9 or 10 o'clock and watch an hour of that. I like 50 Cent Show a little bit more because I could relate to the street aspect of it. Anything that's super kind of street really kind of cuts into the core of what I know. I watch Empire and I'm thinking 70s meets 80s meets some type of reality that's been given to you through a story versus something that they lived. But that being said, I like it. I still watch it. I admire it. I love Taraji. That's my and it's gonna be highs and lows, and they have to find their balances. I think this year they went really overboard with the special appearances, so it's so celebrity driven now, and all of these things are going on. But they were at 22 million for their ratings. And they lost about 2, they're at 19. Last year they started with 10 or 11 and grew to 14. So they're still doubled in last year. So when you, in that regard, it's not really whatever. But, I mean, you do want to heighten your audience. But it's the most that Fox has ever made for a prime television show.
Well,
so it's still a success.
Well, I'll say this.
Mm-hmm.
I got to give love to creator Lee Daniels. But more importantly, for those who watch the show tonight, mm-hmm. there's a rap battle. The winner didn't win.
Spoiler alert, really?
I didn't say who won. I said the winner didn't win.
Who, my girl Breezy?
I didn't say who won.
Mm.
And
Breezy, you gotta
spoiler
come to
alert
the show.
For the
you
following week. I have to say this. Oh. Following week spoiler. Mm. Alicia Keys is on there.
Who's
my ex.
No.
She's on there. My ex is on there. And I damn near wanted to cry because she looks so good. Alicia Keys, if you
she's married.
I think I'm
and we're gonna move right along because I wanna talk about the reality aspect of things and reality shows. I know you have some reality ventures going on that I wanna talk to you about. And I saw something posted that I'm not really sure. Is it called The Bros?
Yeah.
Or something with VH1 that you're involved with? What is that about?
That's a show actually I was creating with my brothers. They not my real brothers, they mm-hmm. like my brothers though, mm-hmm. from Canadian. Columbus, Ohio.
Okay.
And it's a show just about, like, in general life. I think they don't have a show like that yet. I don't really think they have a show of... I think everything is, like, made up, kind of. Like, you know,
I think that they're very producer-driven.
Yeah, I think, like, it's scripted a lot. You know, I don't think it's, like, kind of, like...
Plotted.
Oh, we woke up and went here. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? Because some people really be having funny days.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it's a lot of that. Because that's why some of the shows, people be like, okay... This is fake.
Mm-hmm.
Or you'll see, like, for example, you'll see so-and-so on a show arguing and breaking tires and breaking windows, but you'll see them in the mall. Like, hey, we're the best couple ever, you know what I'm saying? So it's like...
Malik and Milan, what are they named? Miles and Milan, they fighting, breaking windows.
On the TV show. But then,
on the TV.
Like
on the TV.
Yeah.
But you see, like, people you see the same couple in public.
Mm-hmm. So The Bros is in, like, pre-production,
yeah.
you're writing it out, and mm-hmm. it's something that VH1 has shown interest
Man,
in.
Man, it's, we'll see.
We'll see.
We'll see.
Well, good luck.
But,
good
nah,
luck
it's
you,
it's...
You're a writer as well, as far as...
I want to write a book.
Mm-hmm.
I want to, I'm going to write a book, but I want to write a movie too.
Okay. Well, you got, yeah.
My book be about? It'd be called Story of My Situation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think my life is interesting mm-hmm. enough to be able to touch somebody else. It's not for me, and mm-hmm. I don't care about that. It's just, I think it'll touch somebody else and who has a similar story, who can, it's just about believing in you, and that's what a lot of people don't do no more, you know what I'm saying? Because there's a lot of third parties who tell them what they can't do, or, you know, stuff like that, so.
Okay. Is there a process that you go through before making music, since you do write and you do you produce?
No.
Okay, you work with other producers. Mm-hmm. Is there a process that you have to like acclimate yourself to, or is it like you just, some people I know they're constantly writing lyrics in their phone, and then they, you know,
that's one of the things I do, constantly write lyrics. I just make sure I make 2 songs a day or 3 songs a day maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Or I just did a song in Burger King eating mm-hmm. some chicken fries. What's it called? Chicken fries?
Them good, I do though. Not do Burger King. They have
called, yeah.
But I had a
Whopper
today, so.
It's just stuff like that. It's pretty simple. Like, it's not.
No, it's not. Well, I mean, Jay-Z doesn't write it down. He's just off the top.
Right, I mean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, but I know rappers up in here that won't give me 8 bars off the top.
I told y'all, vouch for him. He gave bars a couple weeks ago. He did. Like, he went silent last week.
How does music come to you? Do you ever feel like, you know, because when I was younger, I remember listening to like Foxy Brown, and I used to think I could say every word. But then it's like, as when you're a rapper, it really, like, people take the art of music and performing kind of lightly when they don't really do it. Because it takes a lot of courage. And if you're going to perform, that takes a lot of energy. So to perform and do music, you know. So what's your process like?
Well, my process is just do it. Like, it's really simple. Like, people will be in with everything
else.
Yeah, it's like, just do something. If you want to do it, do it. Like, if you don't, then stop it. Like,
who are some musicians that you,
I like a lot of,
are influenced by, maybe?
Well,
maybe
like
want
a lot
to work
of artists,
with
actually.
You do?
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not anybody who I would like run to, you know, maybe, but
who would you want to work with as a producer?
A producer? Oh man, that's a lot. I want to work at Timberland.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You guaranteed to have a song on Empire doing that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily look for, I mean, that's cool. That'd be dope. But,
that would be dope.
But yeah, I like Timberland and somebody, Pharrell, another one.
Pharrell?
Yeah.
Pharrell and Missy, you just dropped that out. I mean, a video. I wanted to play it, but we might have some issues, so I'm going to just leave it alone.
Leave it alone.
You know, Wendy Williams had the audacity to say that some, I don't even want to bring it up.
Don't even talk.
She sucks.
So, what's next for Dope Jones? Like, where can we see you perform? Your first performance was at the mic.
That was a while
okay,
ago.
Okay, so you're looking, you know what? I have a really good friend that does something that, have you heard of, what's the Thursday night thing called? Industry. I'll tell you about it off camera.
Yeah.
It's something else where you could perform. But I mean, what is the next step for you? You got 7 coming out.
Mm-hmm.
You're writing.
I got so many mixtapes done already, but I've just.
Where do we download them off of?
It's coming out in Dat Piff.
Dat Piff.
Yeah.
Mhm. We'll tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So we need to add writing to your talents too, because you well, not only do you write your music, but you're writing, you're looking to be an author, mm-hmm. you got pre-production work and stuff and all that going on. So where can we, I mean, do we just follow you on Dope Jones?
Yeah, it's about to, it's going to come out on Dat Piff mm-hmm. and live mixtapes.
Okay.
Either Thanksgiving or like early December, mm-hmm. it's going to come out 7 songs. Right after that, I'm going to drop another one.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, they are done already. I'm just, you know, waiting on when I want to drop it, that's all. So
your ultimate goal is to take this from music to TV to eventually film and be an author.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to do music. I want to be a, I'm going to win a Grammy,
mm-hmm.
but I want to be an album artist. Like, it's not a lot of those no more. I think people.
Singles because of the iTunes.
Yeah, I mean, the genre of music is just like, you really don't know what people are saying no more, you know. So I feel like some people, I feel like the rappers are coming back though,
mm-hmm.
you know, and the people who can't rap. If you see, like, people are dying down, like.
I think that comes with, this is my opinion, but I think that comes with A&R has really kind of, left the building as it comes with music. So you're forced to kind of really promote yourself and develop yourself, your artistry. And if it's not really in you, and you don't have that support,
it's gonna be shown.
Yeah. So and then the label is not as interested because the machine behind them really won't support that financially.
Cause you gotta have at the end of the day, you gotta be able to
support. Has social media helped your following for music? It has. I can see that. Mm-hmm.
So but me just being me, really. I just be cool.
I see you too cool for school up in here.
No, I ain't better than nobody, but
I know.
I mean, but like I just rap. I mean, it just make music. If someone was to say, like, I like to have fun, like in places I go, even like on Hollywood Boulevard, this was like Saturday. Mm-hmm. Somebody was like, this girl was rapping, like in a group outside, and I just start rapping with them.
Okay, so you still, We got you. I got you.
There's stuff like that. So.
Okay. Well, I thank you for sharing yourself with us. Is there anything that you want to share with our audience before we get into Miss Sphynix?
No, it's not.
Well, follow you
on Instagram. Dope_Jones_.
Okay.
Same as Twitter. Get your Twitter game up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cleveland, Atlanta, Houston.
The longest story ever, but it's cool.
Do you find that your artistry is being more developed while you're here in California?
I've been to all of those places, so I can
seen the scene.
Yeah,
out there.
So yeah, it's cool. Like, so I can do kind of a lot of stuff with that.
Okay. Well, we're gonna get into one more song, and then I'm gonna switch out. I think I'm gonna play something from you. Is that okay with you?
Yeah, that's okay with me.
Okay, so what would you like to play? What are we going to
do? Can't Get Over You, because I'm performing.
Can't Get Over You. Oh, okay. She's
Bonaventure.
You should come out. It's at the Suede Lounge.
Suede Lounge, Bonaventure. Oh, yeah, I know about it.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
It's the Empire Viewing. Okay.
Tonight. Okay. Mm-hmm. Philly.
So we got
no cover charge.
Maybe you can perform.
I think it's be about $48.
Right.
I have a shot of Jameson. That'd be $48.
$48 longer.
$8.
All right.
So
I really enjoyed you. You're gonna have to come back and visit us often. Okay, follow him, and now we're going to get into Miss Sphynix Roze, who's going to come and talk to us about her journey from Philly all the way to here, that Philly sound that she got, what you know about that, or what is that what it's called? But right now, we're about to get into what? We Can't Get Over You. That sounds like...
I know you can't, baby. I know you can't, baby.
He's silly.
I already know.
He's silly.
I want to know.
What?
She said she can't.
Can't get over you.
You said we won't.
a new Jay. You always got the fresh liner, like the rock you fitted with your liner. Now yeah, boy, you wanna act like you don't see me. I got that walk, boy, I know you see me. Last night you had Twitter hitting my phone, Facebook hitting my phone, had Instagram hitting my phone. I can't get over you, 'cause you keep calling, texting and sending pics. You said we weren't gon' do this. I won't get over you while you keep calling, texting and sending pics. You said we weren't gon' do this. I can't get over you.
I cannot hold a note. Matter of fact, when I am around people, I do have a lot of people around me that are professional in that craft, and I've been told I'm tone deaf. Oh. So, just because I like music, I love it, but don't think I'm over here trying to take it. You know what? I read something. I looked up a few things, and you know, looked up who is Miss Sphynix Roze. They said that some of your sounds, like, you know, when they artists, they remind, I think it was Reverb Nation, mm-hmm. and they said Sade, and I heard that in that. Not saying that, I know some people don't like to be referred to who they sound like, but I heard a little bit of Sade, that smooth,
sultry.
Mm-hmm.
I got Toni Braxton this morning mm-hmm. on another show. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, all of the women that sing in the lower mm-hmm. register, mm-hmm. I get the comparisons.
Those aren't bad comparisons.
They are all awesome.
They're
legends.
All awesome.
I was honored this morning with the Toni comparison. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Sexual chocolate! Sexual chocolate! Sexual chocolate! I mean, congratulations.
Yeah, we want you. Okay, that's excellent. So, born and raised in Philly. Go anybody I know or that is hailing from Philly, they like go Philly. Philly is the brotherly love, the roots, got Eve, got Kevin Hart.
Jill Scott.
Vivian
Green, mm-hmm. Patty Pies.
Patty Sweet Potato Pies. She's a trending topic this week, isn't she?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. So I heard that there were some hardships growing up for you, but what was it like for you growing up in Philadelphia?
Well, I grew up a foster kid, mm-hmm. so I bounced around a lot. Mm-hmm. I lived at like 20-something houses mm-hmm. from the time I was 11 to 21. Mm-hmm. So never knew my mom mm-hmm. Or my dad. Mm-hmm. So that was my life.
That was your life. So was music like a solace for you? Like, was it kind of like your was it therapeutic in a sense that that's how you got it? Because I know I called myself when I was in like junior high or something, I thought that I could write poetry. I didn't think I could write poetry. I did like writing poetry.
Awesome.
But I didn't develop that into right. something else. But I mean, when it's in you, when you're passionate about something you do, so was that something, was that like a happy place for you to write music or do music?
Yeah, writing anything mm-hmm. or reading anything mm-hmm. definitely was escape for me. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so I always wrote. I never really got a chance to pursue anything musically and seriously mm-hmm. until a couple years ago, mm-hmm. just because of that foundation and that structure mm-hmm. being non-existent. Mm-hmm. Where, you know, as an artist, you need a foundation. You
yes.
need parents. You need somebody, auntie,
somebody
uncle,
back
grandma.
Your dream is gonna always...
Somebody, you know. So the talent is just latent and it's just there. And I just truly believe that if you continue to evolve mm-hmm. as a being, mm-hmm. Whatever your destiny is, mm-hmm. you really can't escape it. And if it comes for you, that's you do problem. It.
I watch Super Soul Sunday a lot with Oprah on the OWN Network. I just love that. And I think that's a common theme amongst what is being said. Of course, there are always different topics with different people, but they're all inspirational motivators. Look at Lonzo. Whoa, whoa. Hey, mm-hmm. we got Lonzo Williams. What's going on? Saying like a seller. If you don't know who this is that just walked into the building, we got to say a big, big, big hello to Mr. Lonzo. Well, how are you? Who has a new book out? I got the graphics, though. All right, all right, all right. We're going to talk about your good... This is world-class working crew. You don't know the history? Do you know who Lonzo Williams is? Okay, you know, we have musicians up in here. Okay, okay, okay. He was on my, I could have a repeat. I love when people, guests I like, I invite them back. So you're an entertainer, writer, actresses, and you also have two shows in the works right
in pre-production.
Now. In pre-production, they're reality shows.
Yes.
So, how do you feel about the reality show game? Like watching it and then creating it.
I'm from Philly.
Mm-hmm. Y'all keep it real.
So, being a writer of reality, just to let you know, mm-hmm. it is. It's not a hard script.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most people already know that, but it is scenario-based.
True.
So, the kind of reality shows that I have are not like, they traditionally started out, the cat fights and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I do have a woman show, but it's more of a empowering show.
Okay.
And it's centered around power women mm-hmm. who had struggles in life.
Okay.
And prevailed.
Okay.
So, not all women are going to get along, but it's more of, you just see these power women in their job and what they're doing now, but you also get to see their life following them, because whatever you go through in the past, you still oftentimes have to go back, whether it's a failed relationship and you have children from it, or
you're dealing,
you know,
with,
you're
real
dealing
issues
with taking care
in
of
front
your
of
mother,
yeah,
yeah, or you're looking for your parents or mm-hmm. things like that. So that's the woman show. And then there's another show, which is actually kind of a cop show.
Mm-hmm.
We know Langley's been on for like 3 decades with cops, but we take the cops home.
You take the cops home?
Yeah, so...
At the cops' home.
We go to see the cops at home. We are actually seeing police officers in their life because they are people. They're not machines.
I think that's good that
they're
personalized.
Somebody's mom.
There's a lot of,
there's yeah. somebody's father. There's somebody's grandfather. There's somebody's son, somebody's mm-hmm. daughter, somebody's auntie, somebody's uncle.
Mm-hmm.
So, unfortunately, there's... a great gap and just a big wall between the general public and law enforcement, and that's just something that has built up over the years. So bringing this kind of show, I think, is very revolutionary.
Very.
Mm-hmm. People may or may not receive it well, but the families of police officers will definitely appreciate it.
Well, it gives another spin, because it sounds like you're speaking from a role of positivity where we're getting the other side of it.
Oh, you're going to get to see the real stuff, too, but because, I mean, clearly we won't have, Browns and Fergusons and things like that on there, but you'll see the officers in action. That we're in the cars. We're on the calls.
So it's like an updated version of Cops, but in a reality where you go home.
And you get to know these officers.
Okay.
You know, they're people.
There's some good officers out there. I mean, Lonzo being born and raised in Compton, I know that there's a lot that goes on in Compton. They were even trying to militarize the Compton Unified School District. I think Obama has stopped that. There were some initiatives. But there's a lot going on when it comes to police, that we do need to see both sides of the story, because in a lot of ways they don't get the respect that they need, but then a lot of times it's not given.
So
exactly. Therefore, it's respect is something that's earned. I think you and I have talked about that, and as you know, you create yourselves and create relationships without this entertainment business. Relationships are key to moving forward.
Exactly. And just know that, you know, we're filming in a very small town in Pennsylvania, which is like this is the interesting part. The town is one of the towns that the Underground Railroad actually came through.
Oh,
and wow. So we have so much Civil War history tied to the show. Just different landmarks and things out in Pennsylvania. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania is, you know, our country started there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so much history there. And it's a small town. I mean, indicative of, you know, pretty much what you see today when they go in the little towns and they're filming. So it's basic what you see about Cops, but you know, you got to get to know the lady cop. She's a mom. You know, we got a cop on there named Puerto Rico. He's our Hispanic cop and he's the bomb. And then we have our patriot, you know, who has all the Civil War information, because he's so old, so much older than everybody. But I think it'll be something good for the public. Just depends on what side of the fence you're on. You know what I mean?
I think it's eye-opening. I mean, shows are always good to learn from. I mean, and good for you to have two shows in the works.
Mm-hmm.
So what can we expect from your music?
The music will be changing consistently because I haven't landed in the place where I want to be, or I think I'm going musically, because there's so much of a jazzy undertone to what
it
I do.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't heard all the tracks.
Usually is a little, so you got some up tempo, so you're finding your middle ground and what your
And then I'm a very complex person, so I would never want to be put in a box. See, that's the thing with me. Growing up the way I grew up, I'm not typical. So I can't stay the same all the time. I'm always changing. And so you can expect my music to change. I might do an EDM track. I might do a pop track. I might do a jazz track. I might do an R&B track. I might do a hip-hop track. Right now, when I do fast tracks, I look for hip-hop tracks.
Right.
And I sing R&B over hip-hop.
That's a good
And
look.
Then, some people confuse me for a rapper because I talk a lot on my tracks, but I'm not a rapper. It's just I like Janet's style. So if you remember Janet,
she has
a soft voice, but she talks a lot of trash on her tracks. You know what I mean?
If you think
she's always talking it and singing it. Mm-hmm. So that's a lot of the style that I have. But ultimately, it'll be a little, as I get older, I'll land on a little bit more jazzy tone, you know, get into the soul genre. Right now, it's too much pop, so.
So you're finding your place with music, and you're just putting out like singles.
Mm-hmm.
So we talked about the major label versus independent route, and I think that even bringing up Waka Flocka earlier, he's having a really big fight right now publicly with Atlanta Records about just not feeling like they're supporting him as an artist. I think that especially for someone in your position that's starting out and finding certain songs, you're really A&Ring yourself and getting feedback from your audience. So do you enjoy the independent route? Because I know it's much harder.
Oh, I love it. I mean, I was trained by Philly's Gravy Chapter, Gamble and Huff, The Sound of Philadelphia. That's how I was discovered in the Fridays in Philly. And bought in for training. They don't sign artists anymore, as everyone knows. But, you know, they will train you. They train independent artists. And I stayed under them for training for 2 years. We learned how to sing from my diaphragm versus my throat. And it's like they tell me up front, you know, this is the industry. All they're offering right now is 360 deals. You're a writer. You're into a whole lot of stuff. You want to give up a portion of everything that you're doing?
Yeah.
Just to get, you know, some backing from the music. So the
do
way
you
I look
like
at music.
Backup or
no.
No, you're just totally
I do.
You.
I'm totally me. And I sing my own backgrounds. Mm-hmm. I do my own. I write my own music. Mm-hmm. I seek out tracks. Mm-hmm. So I don't make the music, but I seek out tracks that I would like to get on. Mm-hmm. I lease them. Mm-hmm. And that's where I am right now. And this is what I say about music. Music doesn't really make money anymore, especially as an independent artist. Mm-hmm. You have to have the money to make the music.
Right, that's okay. Why I say the independent route is harder because of the financial backing.
So you better love it.
You have to love
you
it.
You better love what you're doing and just do it and do it because you love it. And if someone happens to like it enough to put some funds behind you or something like that, fine. But this is music is something that I love to do that happens naturally for me. And that's why I do it. It's not for the money. I'm financially secure. So it's not that I'm looking for money for a record deal. I make music because I love to make music.
And it's
in me.
Okay.
And I feel very free and I enjoy performing. So I write, you know, I like the writing side of it. And the performing is because I have the ability to do it.
Okay.
I love music. I love it. I love the whole.
I like your sound. I definitely can chill out and listen to this. I could love Roze. I love it. I love it. I love it. So you write. Is there Arthur going to be one of your many talents? I could see you writing a book. You've had an interesting story of life.
Yeah, people have been speaking that book into my life for many, many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
People I've run across, and it's been a lot in my life.
Mm-hmm.
So it's called The Way of the Butterfly. There is a book and that I'm authoring, but I'm putting it out as a fiction book.
Yeah, so it's kind of semi-based.
Yeah, because, you know, the foster care world is the very, I mean, you know, people hate when I say it's taboo, but I'm the kid. I'm the foster kid. And it is taboo. And then the issues and the things that go on while you're in foster care, the world does not want that stuff brought to light. So it has to go in a fiction book.
I get
so
it.
That it's accepted and it's received. But it will still be an empowering book for youth coming up in the same situation. There's, you know, 80% of our prison population were foster children.
I could believe that because anyone that doesn't...
And that's a current statistic.
Mm-hmm. Well, Phoenix, I'm looking forward to your music and congratulations. You also have, is it called the GOM Enterprises that you give back with children that
are in Sphynix Project.
Sphynix Project,
yes.
That you also have and that you give back to foster kids. So not only have you been through that world, but you also give back to give your side of the story and encourage
them. Let them talk, you know, to somebody who's been through it, because I was there talking to people who didn't have my life.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you really understand what I'm talking about or, you know, what I'm going through as a child or a teen coming up? So I like to, you know, go in person and have those conversations. And the children, believe it or not, they know sincerity when they look
recognize.
In your eyes.
Especially
they
when they've been
it's a vibration, you know, so I enjoy that part. That's like my favorite part, hanging out with the kids or whatever I can do, you know.
Love that. Okay. Well, I would love to get into that part of it more, but I appreciate you coming.
Thank
so
you.
So we want to announce that you will be at the Suede Lounge
tonight. Yeah.
Okay, and that's at 7 p.m.?
Well, the doors open at 6.
The doors open at 6?
And I think
no
it goes
cover.
To 2:30 in the
till
morning.
2:30.
But the performances, I think they don't start till around 9.
Okay. Well, you gotta go get your zen on and get ready.
I do. I zen all day long on my phone. Yes, oh. I do.
Philly, Philly. Okay. I hope you've been keeping your boy Meek Mill in prayer.
Oh, hell no.
He always comes off the woodwork. He always comes
it's expressed on the phone.
I
want to
know.
Okay,
why
so congratulations
so
on all of that. Your 215 stilettos. The oath of honor and everything that you have. You're so multi-talented. We're gonna have to get you back in here. But I gotta talk to my guy Lonzo.
Lonzo. Really
cool. Lonzo got some. I just sent you the cover of his book. Did you get it? Just now. So yeah, I want to get to talk to Lonzo. He's another author who's been through the music business and has a long history. I mean, if you know, you gotta look him up. If you don't know, read his book. If you don't know.
But Mr. Better ask somebody.
You better ask somebody. And NWA, for his terms, is not without Lonzo, not without a Lonzo.
Okay.
Okay. So, hey now, hey now, hey, hey now. So, thank you, Sphynix. Anything you. Else? Let's follow you on S. Give them your, because it's okay. An underscore, and I spelled it wrong about 4 times, and I pronounced it wrong initially. Okay. So I just want them to know how to follow you and catch you at the Sway Lounge tonight.
Okay, so SoundCloud.com, Sphynix, Sphynix, mm-hmm. hyphen, Roze, Roze, and Twitter and Instagram is Sphynix underscore. On Facebook, I'm just Sphynix Roze. I own all my social media.
Oh. Yes, there it is there.
Oh. Okay. Type it in, you'll find me. Sphynix, Sphynix, not Sphinx.
Sphynix. Not, I said Sphynix. It's like Phoenix, but
with a Sphynix.
With the Sphynix.
Yes.
All right. Well, I appreciate
thank you. For having
you. Thank you. Appreciate you telling your story. Mm-hmm. This Miss Successful, Miss Phoenix Rose. Lonzo?
Yes, baby.
Can you tell me about your bookwork? I want to know because you got some new stuff coming out. Come on. We're going to switch it out
We're going to switch it out, but I want to know.
10 minutes. Okay. You can't. Why?
I feel like bumming some NWA why? Right now. Some more ice cube.
So, okay. So, I'm cover, Mr. Lonzo. Yes. Welcome.
How you doing, darling? I'm back.
I'm back. Yeah, I know you back.
I told y'all something back when the book came out.
I know
I'm here.
I'm so happy. So, when you previously came in here, we talked about, because a lot of people, the record, I don't even remember what I was doing with Record Crew.
How old are you?
Old enough to know who you
wasn't
are,
record
but
yeah. Your daddy just met your mama when the record crew was coming out.
Why?
How you doing?
I'm wonderful.
I'm good.
I did it now. Yeah, you're doing wonderful. So, how has, okay, the NWA movie just came out. It wasn't a documentary. It was a full feature film. They made it for under $30 million, and now they're gross probably almost at $200
million. Over
$200. Over $200 million. A lot of people, even Ice Cube, said that he couldn't believe some of the things that he heard that came out of it. As you know, like, I don't remember that part of the story, but they separated it so in so many things. Everyone has their side of the story. Mm-hmm. But you being an originator of this music, I mean, it wasn't even rap that you started. You started that feel good love music. You know what I mean?
Did it all, baby.
You did it all. You had the boom boom room.
Mm-hmm, the law.
Boom boom room, baby.
The boom. Now they even put boom, that in the movie.
The doodle.
The doodle. Yeah, I know they're using it. You know, they would have to put a little extra check in your pocket, but it's cool.
I could use it. I ain't mad at
them. I ain't mad at them. But I mean, really, there would be no Dr. Dre. I mean, I won't say it would not be. But it would not be the Dr. Dre that we know if he didn't have the experiences that he had with you. Because
right.
You had the forethought to have your own equipment, your own place of business. You had
studio,
own studios
club.
And all that. And as he DJed, you had him in the club, you did that. So you fostered that whole Compton pretty much generation.
Chopped down the bushes, paved the way, paved the sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
Laid the concrete. Street lights.
Okay, and so they had to come and talk to you and get your opinion to base some of this movie on. So what is your book about? It's called, tell us what it's called and what is it about. You got that? Okay, so we're going to pull up the cover of it so we can see.
That's me right here.
Yeah, that's you right there.
My book is called NWA, mm-hmm. Not Without Alonzo.
Mm-hmm.
It's the history of West Coast hip hop. Mm-hmm. It tells you my very beginning on how I got started.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, that's it.
That's it right there.
That's that handsome bald head right there.
Right there.
You gotta have it.
Right.
I was pre-Jerry Curl. After all the Jerry Curls and everything went away, Jerry Curls was not good for brother's head.
Jerry Curl, S-Curl, you had it all.
I had it all. I had a perm, S-Curl, natural, and as you can see right now, all I got is some stubble. Okay.
That's all good. It's just better than brother.
Hey, that's what they tell me. Mm-hmm. Anyway.
Not without Alonzo.
Anyway, baby, it takes you back to the early roots, not only of Lonzo, but in Compton, because what people don't, most people don't realize is that I was the first DJ in Compton, first mobile DJ in Compton.
For Michelet, they all worked with them. With JJ Fad, or am I going to?
JJ Fad, we distributed JJ Fad's first single.
Okay.
So,
I don't know if they can see this, but my audience can't, from Yo-Yo, Above the Law, West Side Connection, Death Row Records, connecting the labels and the label recording artists, King T, Ice T, Joe Cooley, Battle Cat, when
Dre them left, Battle Cat went on tour with me.
Skate Land, Unknown, DJ Fat, DJ Yella, the CIA, Crew Cut Records, and they all, if it was not Lonzo, all of these branches came from Lonzo. Even Death Row, Aftermath, so all of that came from that.
When Easy wanted to do Ruthless Records, he came to me first, because I'm the only one he knew that in the record business. Right. He came to me first. I'm the one hooked up Easy with Jerry Heller. Mm-hmm. He didn't meet Jerry Heller in a warehouse at McCullough Records.
And why Jerry Heller is trying to sue the movie now, they said defamation of character, that he felt like he was not represented correctly in the film.
If he win, I'm going to sue too, because I wasn't a hater, but I wasn't
a
no hater.
A lot of people, even, not Yella, but Ren had an issue. He went publicly. He went hard on some show when they asked him about it.
Well, you know what, babe? Understand this. And mm-hmm. I tell people all the time, mm-hmm. first and foremost, just like the NWA music, mm-hmm. the movie is entertainment. Mm-hmm. Okay?
And they had to put a spin. It's semi-fictional.
Right. It's a biopic. Biopic.
Gotcha.
When you do a biopic, that gives you a lot of license to do things that normally didn't happen. The situation between me and Dre mm-hmm. and Ice Cube was shot at Dudo's mm-hmm. never happened. Mm. It never happened. Ice Cube never saw the inside of Dudo's. But the situation happened. What happened was, just so you know, mm-hmm. what happened was, at Dudo's was huge. Mm-hmm. It held 2,000 people. Mm-hmm. And it was right there on the corner of Pyru. Pyru was the next street over, in blood territory, okay? So I had to hire Compton PD.
One second.
I had to hire Compton PD mm-hmm. to secure Dudo's. Because Dudo's was so big, I dropped my age limit from 18 at Eve After Dark down to 14, 15 at Dudo's. It's still legal.
Really?
Yeah, oh, yeah. You can still,
if they didn't have alcohol.
Right, no alcohol. So now, Dre's cousin, mm-hmm. Jinx, who was in the movie, mm-hmm. Dre allowed Jinx to do a song mm-hmm. at Dudo's called My Penis. Okay? So I got 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds. I got the Compton PD as my security. Jinx does this song called My Penis. It was a lieutenant that was on my security team. He pulls me to the side and says, Lonzo, look here, man. We appreciate the overtime and the extra money, but you're going to make us do our job. What's your problem? Okay, what's the problem?
He said that was kind of not lawful at that time.
You can't do that. You can't do X-rated lyrics in front of teenagers. Okay? He told me, look, I'm going to give you a warning, but that technically that's contributing to the delinquency of a minor.
You sure he wasn't saying my Adidas?
No, it was actually, it was ripped off of my Adidas. They used the Run DMC track.
So see how musically inclined I am?
Yes,
I don't care
you
if
are.
I can't hold a note. I got this.
But he tells me, you know, I can arrest you for that, okay?
But he not,
because
you Lonzo.
But then I would just...
Lonzo.
A guy paying some money, okay?
Okay, I got you.
And so I go off on Dre, not because Q did the gangster lyric. I went off on Dre because he got me jammed by the police. Police that I'm paying. Mm-hmm. So that was the problem we had. And it just, you know, they took that scenario and flipped it, put something else. I've never heard Q, here we go again. I have never in my life heard Q do a gangster lyric in my presence. Not when he was a teenager. I've never been to one of his concerts. I've never been to an NWA concert. Mm-hmm. So I've never...
It wasn't many.
Right. I've never seen Cube do a gangster lyric in person anywhere. So when Cube was with me, he was doing Beastie Boy knockoffs.
Now he's shooting Ride Along too.
Right.
So I mean, it's post production. It's not out yet. But yeah.
So yeah, it was a whole different thing, baby. It was it took a lot of liberties on that movie. I tell people all the time, understand it's a movie, and if you believe everything you saw, you also believe that yellow Camaros can do karate on the 405 freeway.
What?
I don't even believe that there's a DeLorean that goes into the time machine.
I
want to
know.
Good girl. Good girl.
I know. I want to see what that boom boom room was like, though.
I bet you do.
Boom boom room.
Yeah.
The boom boom room
was cracking.
The boom
but
boom.
But I know
room.
You still got stuff going on.
We still. I'm still very active in the adult entertainment field.
Oh, word.
Ooh.
What the boom room is?
What do you think it was?
So I need to.
No, you don't. No, you don't. You stay out of that.
I'm just trying to get.
Unless you want a part-time job, that's what I'm talking about.
It is male stripper.
That's the boom boom.
Oh,
room,
that's
man.
Called
boom
boom. Okay, yeah, I got you.
That's adult entertainment.
You know what? When I think of adult entertainment, I don't know. My mind went to sex or something. Like I'm thinking toys. And
yeah,
shit.
If you got somebody shaking your wang wang in your face, that is sex.
Bruh.
No, that is not sex. Put it in. Bruh. Inside is sex.
It's right there.
Forget the right track.
That's too close.
Say, get right the right track. Gonna be right in your face.
Oh my God! Talking about AOD is getting their own reality show. Can you take that?
Who?
AOD, Ace of Diamonds, which is a strip club in West Hollywood.
Are you serious?
They have officially gotten their own reality show.
Wow!
So shout out to all you reality producers for putting it out there. You.
That well,
and
you,
I know you next.
Well, I'm next.
You next.
I just shot a pilot.
You next?
But tell you hi.
Who that?
Has.
Tell him I said hello.
I just got on a song with them. I was at the studio last night. I just got on that.
Yeah, at the five.
Okay.
That he's doing on Sunday.
Okay. I'll be there.
Yeah.
I'm signing books and signing second books.
I can't believe you didn't bring me a book line.
Baby,
so,
know what?
It's cool.
I changed cars at the last minute.
You
I left my bag in the car.
Yes, in the Rolls. I understand.
No. I just... You deserve the Jag. I couldn't come up in the Xbox. I jumped in the Jag for you, but my bag is in the Xbox.
I just love you so much,
Lonzo.
I
want to know.
So cool. I still think that we need to do an on the scene interview before they tear down that Compton Swap Meet.
You better hurry up because you can't get nowhere near it. It's a fence around it.
Oh, the Compton Swap Meet?
No,
yeah, it's a fence around it. You can't get nowhere near.
We know how to do.
You gotta hop. You gotta put your ticket out of them heels.
We're gonna do it next week. So look, everybody, go. Where's your site, and how can they get this book? Because you're doing book signings all over. Do we just follow you? Is there a website? But I want everybody to go check this book out. It's a lot of history in it. A
lot of
you're
history.
Into hip hop, if you're into music, especially if you saw N.W.A. If you're familiar with the World Class Record Crew, if you know anybody involved with this. It all started with this man right here, Lonzo Williams. So tell him how we can get your book, know more about it, see what you got going on.
Simply at LonzoWilliams.com. Go to LonzoWilliams.com. It'll send you
no
a link. No A.
It's Lonzo.
But the book is Alonzo. But you can see if you call me
not
with an A.
Without Alonzo.
My real name was Alonzo. So it fit for the book.
Right.
But on the streets, I'm Lonzo. That's
well, that
kind of cool.
That was for your mom. She gave you that government name, and sometimes you know we.
I don't even. If you call my house, ask for Alonzo Williams. He ain't never home.
Yeah, bruh.
He ain't never home.
If Alonzo Williams, no. If Alonzo Williams, no, he's not. Can I help you, please?
That's how I feel. If they don't call, asking for the princess, I don't know who they're talking about.
I ain't mad. Amen.
Well, thank you for coming to Beauty and the Beat. I know you rushed over here because you had a previous engagement.
Yes, ma'am.
We split up all our time here and we worked it out.
I appreciate you. Thank you very much.
I appreciate you.
Okay.
And go to Lonzo Williams and get that NWA book.
LonzoWilliams.com.
Go to SoundCloud. Get familiar with my girl, Sphynix Roze. And go check out Dope Jones, who got that 7 mixtape coming out.
Wes.
West, the most interesting is in the building.
Most interesting,
the
you know I'll be.
The executioner is telling me squat. To sign out.
Squad.
Squad up. You know, you heard he's doing his music now?
No.
He got a love song out. He need a girlfriend right now.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Who got a love song?
I need love.
You got an LL version? You got, shoot.
First of all, the song is called
bars.
Long
give
Wood.
Give me 8 bars. Hey, we're going off the air, but give me 8 bars. Cousin, give me 8 bars.
I want to
not tonight. Not tonight. We gotta go.
Peace. We gotta go. You don't have to do it on air. Okay, we signing off for Beauty and the Beat. Thank you, all my guests, for coming in. Follow us on Beauty and the Beat Radio on IG. But cousin, you not gonna give me a little bit of something?
Wes? Okay, I wanna know.
Make a way for it. Make a way.